I've got a guy over there selling Christian cards, a woman over here doing freedom of sexuality and ending human trafficking, someone over there selling herbs. Like, it is a plethora of different points of views,
right?
All with the common thread of, we'd like the government to stay out of our bedroom, stay out of our brain, and let us decide what we want to decide. Mm-hmm. And that resonates with me. I like that.
It's a big connection for me, too. And, you know, I always go back to the quote from my hometown senator and former presidential candidate, Barry Goldwater, and he said, to disagree, one does not have to be disagreeable. And I like that you can have Christians for Liberty and Atheists for Liberty on the same row. And everybody is amicable.
They're getting along.
Right.
Because they care. You don't have to agree with me, but I'd like you to have your own opinion. And that's not a message you hear from the mainstream media.
No.
For sure. Or from your local church or from your local family. You should do what we want to do. What did you find most interesting in yesterday's sessions? Because you had some great people. You were sitting at this table interviewing presidential candidates and movie stars and celebrities. I mean, I know the list is too long, but what was your highlight from yesterday?
Well, you know, today Mike Rowe is doing his big presentation, and so I had an opportunity to talk to him about his foundation and how he's really helping out individuals find vocational careers, you know, that are honorable, great work that you can make a great living and build a wonderful life. And so we talked a bit about his foundation, and of course, I'm the old-fashioned girl, so he has a new whiskey out, so we talked about his fine spirits. Daryl Davis gave a really compelling presentation. Now, this man is amazing. Imagine being a black man and you infiltrate the KKK. Not only do you infiltrate the KKK, but you've done it in such a way that you've been able to elevate the thinking and have them leave the KKK.
No, he sat down with the Grand Wizard in his home having coffee and saying, well,
right,
let's talk about what happened in history. You give me your version and I'll give you mine.
Yes.
And he's changing minds of not only white people and black people and people all over the world, which is not just an American problem. Racism is a worldwide problem. He was phenomenal, and I hope you guys got to see what he did. He was fantastic.
Yes, and that interview, he came across really well. Ennis Freedom was another one that I really enjoyed. You know, imagine, you know, your family's missing, right? And you can't get answers from your, you know, home country's government. And then you start speaking out about it, and you get moderate support, but then you start speaking about other atrocities in other countries, and then you lose your job.
You need to get fired if you talk about other atrocities.
Yes.
You can work for us, but only if you shut your mouth, and then you can get a paycheck. He is interesting.
Yeah, he was a great one. His presentation was compelling. Again, we have an international presidential candidate, and Gloria Alvarez is running for president of Guatemala. And so she gave a compelling talk, and she's got very interesting ideas, and she's very fond of liberty.
And she's funny. She has a YouTube video where she dresses up like, you know, a Soviet teacher with the crazy beret, and it's so charming, and I think people can relate to it because it's comedy, it's socialism, it's capitalism, and I think the message comes through really clearly.
Right, and she has to illustrate it in those kind of terms and take it to a clownish, satirical level. So the young people that she's after understand that the right and the left are the problems there.
Yeah, because there's a whole group of people voting in that country that believe communism, socialism is the way out of their struggle. And she's like, guys, you've been lied to. You've been lied to.
Right.
Take my message. So those kind of people are here, and they're walking the halls and saying hello, and I wish you guys were here because it's really cool.
Yeah, I mean, they come right up to you, and they'll have a conversation with you. It's amazing. You know, I got to have a chat with Brett Weinstein. Like, the list goes on. Seriously. You know, Maj Touré, Black Gun Matters. He's doing some phenomenal things with his Solutionary University and helping educate and uplift his community. It's more than just about being armed. It's about being educated and creating a life worth living.
Well, I like him a lot. I'm looking forward for him to be on my show, but he basically created a movement with a controversial headline, Black Guns Matter, but his messaging is smart. He's smart, he's articulate, and he's motivated thousands of people around Philadelphia and now nationwide to do something about the problem. And that's the thing, these people are not sitting by complaining. No one's a victim here, we're making it better.
Okay, well, we have some really exciting things coming up. And let's talk about today, if you don't mind.
I think that's, we're about to give this to the live feed, to the big stage, so let's figure out what's on tap.
Yeah, but they're waiting on us, so, but we want to make sure
should.
That, well, of course, because we have something meaningful to say. So we got some cool panels coming up. So this one I like, Not Your Father's Saturday Cartoon. It's the reinvention of animation. So that's going to be an interesting panel.
When we were kids, Saturday morning is the only time you could watch cartoons. And now you have adult cartoon channels. You have, so he's reinventing the cartoon.
Right.
Great thing about cartoons, you can get away with stuff you could never do with a live actor. Like Archer and South Park and those cartoons and those comedy people are like, oh, that's really funny. But if a person said that stuff, you would be slayed.
Right, because and as an actor or an actress, like now you're branded that way. Even if it wasn't you saying it, it was your character saying it, then you have those challenges. So we've got environmental stuff coming up. We've got Unleashing Prosperity with Grover Norquist and a tax reform panel that I'm actually moderating.
There are films that are being
there
shown.
There are films,
the
too.
The filmmakers are here, and they're doing things that hopefully can change. Documentaries are expensive. They don't make a lot of money. And these people put their own time and money into trying to change the world.
So today's slate for the Anthem Film Festival is The Vampire, The Baby Formula Drug Dealer, Alien, we've got Call Me Mule, and then Joanne Skousen, the founder of the film festival, she is interviewing a man, Letters from Sing Sing, 20 years of incarceration, where he was wrongly convicted. So those are just some of the things. We've got a big luncheon with Tulsi Gabbard and Ennis Freedom called Off the Record. So you'll be able to ask them all kinds of questions. And the Eureka Summit kicks off. So there's all kinds of small business opportunities to learn about how to build a better business. So focusing on that. The Subversion Summit, you know, we've got liberation through innovation. Yesterday they talked about AI. Today they've got some really great panels coming up. Again, we've got
just to be clear, there's
micro.
Not just one thing going on. There's summits,
there's
summits,
several
it's
things.
A comedy festival, a film festival, all under one roof, and we're live from Memphis, Tennessee, USA, and you guys are all over the world, and we thank you for being here.
Yes, so let's go to the main stage right now, and we can pick it up at Freedom Fest Main Stage Live.
Is every year I do a white mates and two chess problem. It's out there in the lounge area. You go there and every day I have a new chess problem. The first person who solves it gets a silver dollar. They just need to track me down, show me that they've solved the problem, and they get a silver dollar. So that happens in the exhibit hall. Whenever there's a break, check it out. It's always a lot of fun for those of you who are chess players. The other thing about the silver dollar is that this is our symbol of sound money and liberty. It's got all the symbols that are great about America on the silver dollar. And we have the 2003 silver dollars. I've asked all the coin dealers in the exhibit hall to make sure they have a silver dollar, because if you buy a silver dollar, one or more, you bring it to the closing panel on Saturday. And we have a picture where you come up on stage with Steve Forbes and our other celebrities, maybe even Robert Kennedy, and we will take a picture together holding this symbol of liberty. So be sure to do that. Today is going to be a fantastic day. We have our Global Economic Summit. We have a lot of breakout sessions. We have our luncheon with Tulsi Gabbard and Enos Kander, Freedom. There's lots of events going on, especially our breakout sessions, so you don't want to miss those. So who is our MC? None other than Kennedy. So let's welcome Lisa Kennedy as our MC extraordinaire. And look at this beautiful outfit. Oh, my gosh.
Hi, everyone. How are we? Are we caffeinated? Are we rejuvenated? Are we hydrated? That's one of the most important things, especially in a humid city. You don't realize the nutritional needs that you have, especially in terms of, you know, rejiggering the system in the liver after a night. So the liquid IV, the Gatorade, whatever you can do, Pedialyte, get it in your system now because you're going to want to be as sharp as a tack. Today is a big day, and this is one of the most important ways that we can launch the first full day of FreedomFest. Are you ready for the Global Economic Summit? Oh, I love to hear it. Well, moderating the panel is a very smart and learned young man. He went to two of my favorite schools as an official Hoosier and Indiana girl. He has degrees from Purdue and IU, Indiana University, as well as Johns Hopkins and Northwestern. So the man has been all over the map. He started at Money Map Press in 2011 as an economist and researcher, and now he runs the whole damn thing, and hopefully one day the world with limited government, liberty-minded people who want to take the globe back from the globalists and the technocrats. So without further ado, let's launch into the Global Economic Summit with Garrett Baldwin. Enjoy.
Things in life are free, but you can give them to the birds and bees. I want money. That's what I want.
I'm gonna sit with you.
That's what I want.
Good morning, everybody.
That's what I want.
Steve? Good morning, everybody. I hope everybody's having a great day. My name's Garrett Baldwin. I am the executive publisher of Money Map Press and Republic Research. There were some rumors going around that some people were upset because the bar at the Sheraton closed at 10:15 last night. I just want to tell you that that might be a cosmic welcome because, as you know, if you remember in college, economics was always taught before 9 o'clock in the morning. So be very content. I'm happy that everybody is here. We're going to break into this and just jump in. Steve Forbes, everybody, no introduction needed. He's the chairman and editor of Forbes Media. His new podcast, What's Ahead, engages top newsmakers, politicians, and business pioneers. And he is an absolute expert on the intersection of politics, society, and economics. Steve, I'm going to start with you. You're the presidential candidate in 1996 and 2000, so everything that is wrong afterward, that is all of our fault. The United States Heritage Economic Freedom Index has ranked the United States 25th overall. We were 8th in 2008. What went wrong, and how do we right this ship?
What went wrong is government. To a fare thee well, the far left is making a determined effort to churn the United States into some version of a European stagnant economy. And they are relentless in every way. They are practicing what you might call modern socialism. You know, the socialists in the days of old thought you had to seize assets, nationalize things. The modern socialist is much smarter. Those socialists realize you don't need to seize things, you just make sure you regulate them in a way in which their existence depends on the whims of bureaucrats and Washington politicians. And you see this in the case of our president. You know, he still makes statements occasionally, but it doesn't matter. The far left runs those bureaucracies, those so-called independent agencies. And you see the regulations everywhere, whether it's forcing us to use EVs when only about 1 out of 10 want to do it. You see it the war on fossil fuels. You see it on the war on showerheads, air conditioners, gas stoves, and everything else. Dishwashers now takes 10 hours to do what a dishwasher could do 1 hour a few years ago. Anything that makes life worth living and more pleasurable, there again. And you see it in New York City and pizzas, for crying out loud. They're now going after pizzas made from wood-burning and coal-burning stoves, which have been around for decades. They say, this is to save the environment. No, it isn't. It's to shaft New Yorkers and force them to move. However, they now want a war on air conditioners, so if you do move, you're going to sweat to death in places like Texas and Florida. But in the thing about New York, I think this epitomizes what's happening in terms of the loss of freedom. On the pizzas, they say, well, they emit emissions, you know, carbon dioxide. However, as somebody pointed out, John Kerry's aircraft, if you take that those emissions, over 100,000 tons a year, it would take a typical wood-burning stove 849 years to match the emissions of what John Kerry does in 1 year, flying around telling us how bad we are. And in the days of old, as you know, in medieval times, you could buy, when the church was corrupt, you could buy what they call indulgences. And that is, if you were a sinner, you could make a contribution, and that would guarantee you a smooth ride to heaven. So what they do, the modern version of indulgences, is they say carbon offsets. What are carbon offsets? They say, we're making contributions to study climate change. Doesn't wash. You are emitting, period. Just as those sinners were sinning, period. And no amount of money was going to get you around it. But it just all goes to show, they all want central planning. They all want low growth. They don't care about growth rates. They care about control. And you see it in the Federal Reserve. It is accepted by even many conservatives, the idea that the Fed can control and guide the economy. They can't. How central planning doesn't work. And yet they manipulate interest rates, which is a form of rent control. We know rent control, what that does to a real estate market. Well, look what they did in the last 15 years. Zero interest rates, free money. Governments loved it. The politicians loved it because they could spend and the cost of the debt went down. It'd be like charging $10,000 to your credit card and the monthly payment went down. They loved it. And then inflation comes along and oopsie-daisy, you got a crisis on your hands. Companies, free money, a lot of them borrowed to a fare thee well. Now they're in trouble. Consumers, a lot of them are now in trouble. So what? The reason the index is declining, and I'm surprised we're still number 25, and then I realize a lot of other countries are doing crazy things too. So it's not as if it's a wisdom index. It's a measure index, a wisdom index. And this is why the 2024 elections and conclusion is so important. Where is the United States going to go? Are we going to go forward with the kind of principles and policies that made us a nation that attracted people who wanted, as Lincoln put it, to improve their lot in life and create great things and do great things? Or are we going to become a stultifying, no offense to Europe, but you're, that's right, Barbara, we got to make, that's why we got to make you head of the EU. Stultifying where no risks are taken, you stultify, the bureaucracies multiply, and we stagnate, and we continue to lose freedoms.
Let's talk a little bit about that. The process, in one word, is dirigisme, which is a French term. Let's talk about Europe. Dr. Barbara Kolm is the president of the Hayek Institute, founding director of Austrian Economic Center, and the Austrian Central Bank director. All right, let's dig into this. Post-COVID, what do you think what countries in Europe have done it right when it comes to economic freedom and progress, and what do you think has done it wrong?
Well, more or less, all of them have done it wrong, put it this way. We are literally in a decline. We've been in not only in a technical recession, we are in a recession ever since Q3 of last year, and the numbers literally don't look good. And there are single countries like Hungary that is bashed by many, but they did at least with regards to their defense of individual freedom a lot. The Swedes did it much better than many other countries in continental Europe, but more or less the rest has all followed the same trap, and we have lost our individual freedom. So if you could summarize Europe in the following way. We have outsourced our energy supply to Russia. We have outsourced our production of industry production of cheap industry goods to China. And we have outsourced our security to the US. And so what is left for Europe? I mean, nothing, to be honest.
We have
museums and beautiful landscapes.
Bicycles.
And 24 million small and medium-sized enterprises who actually carry the burden high taxation, and of course, who are innovative and creative. So this is the only hope that we have, those small, medium-sized family-owned or enterprises with 300, 400, 500 people who are really in many ways upfront in innovation, but all over the rest is, as you mentioned already, central planning. And Hayek would spin in his grave if if he knew what was happening. We have two central planners. We have central planning in Brussels, mm-hmm. and we have central planning in Frankfurt at the mm-hmm. European Central Bank. I mean, we finally go back to normalization of monetary policy. But first of all, way too late and way too little. I mean, we are lagging behind the Fed, who did not do a great job either. I'm not here to criticize the Fed, but I just may say we did it in Europe just 1 year too late. And we're just still rising interest rates, but you know, what is our star? The natural mm-hmm. interest rate. Now, this is the price for money. And if it's still negative, what do you expect from people?
All right.
So this doesn't look good for us, unfortunately.
I want to introduce Preity Upala. She is a great thought leader, absolute media rock star, and the advisor to the Europe India Chamber of Commerce and Industry. As you look at India and China, you look at the current situation, where do you see progress? Where do you see India moving forward? Will be the right now on pace to be the second largest economy within the next couple of decades. How does India influence the global economy?
Well, good morning, everyone, and lovely to be here again. Don't have great news for you. Global growth is not looking good. It tops at 3% next year, and you break it down, Europe, UK, forget about it, it's 0.4%, I think, and US, I mean, lucky to get over 1%. I love talking about the Asian markets because they're, you know, quite dynamic in comparison. I'll talk both about India and China. We'll start with India. It remains the fastest growing economy in the world post-COVID and post-conflict, I want to say, growing at 6.5% this year and predicted to grow between 6 and 7 over the next 5 years consistently, which is remarkable for any economy under the current economic environment. Its GDP, it's headed to $5 trillion by 2025. I think that's the best guesstimate. And yes, it should be the third largest in a few years and maybe in a decade or so, maybe the second largest. So, I mean, the stage is set for India. It's got all the right ingredients, but I think, and it seems like everybody has signed up for the India story, which is great, and I think there was none better evidence than when the Prime Minister visited the U.S. Recently and the White House rolled out the red carpet like nobody's business, which is great. It's great to see the largest and the oldest democracies working together. I think that partnership really is going to be the most important one in the next half of the century. And I always say it's the Asian century, but I think India is going to play a key role. The semiconductor chip race is really the most important race in the world right now. Whoever dominates the chip industry will really dictate the geopolitics of our time. And everybody's vying for it. I think India would want to be a pivotal player in repositioning the semiconductor global supply chains. It would have to work with the market leader like Taiwan for that to happen. It's very early days for India, but I think it's headed in the right direction. Data is the new oil, chips are the new gold. So this is the world that we find ourselves in. Just very quickly on China. China is a lot more complicated than India. Growing at 5.4% and predicted to grow at 5% next year. Unfortunately, their economy is at the risk of deflation. So it, you know, prices are gonna come down, which means they won't be spending as much. It's not good for an already downward spiraling economy. Property prices as well as their exports are seeing a steep decline. Recovery is very slow. The government might want to step in, which is never a good thing. And I think beyond just numbers, the post-COVID, there seems to be like a Chinese fatigue that's set in, at least in the West. And geopolitical tensions are making countries really look for alternatives. And we will see that. It will not happen overnight because I think they've cemented their place in manufacturing and global supply chains, but I feel like the whole world should work in tandem to organically wean itself off of China. So that's where the world is at. Not looking pretty, but let's hope for the best.
I just spent some time in Switzerland, and I'm looking out into the world of places that I could be optimistic about. While I was driving down the road, a friend of mine said, what do you notice about the vehicles? I said, well, they're all very expensive. He said, well, no, look very closely. And it was no bumper stickers on any of the cars because no one wanted to put any political slogans on an $85,000 car, unlike here in the U.S. If we look at the current status of the world, Steve, is there anywhere that you look at it and you say, they're doing it right, we should emulate some of their policies?
I think the answer is right here in the United States. You have, Dickens had the tale of two cities. Here we have the tale of two states, or two groups of states, red and blue. This is the virtue of the U.S. federal system, is that you have a number of states pursuing low taxes, pro-business, individual opportunity, parents now in many states controlling the money for the education of their kids in schools, so you can choose anything, anywhere you want. And so this is going to make a sharp contrast to 2024, red state versus blue. And this is why I'm optimistic about the U.S. once we get past 2024, is precisely we have the largest states like California, Florida, Tennessee, and others showing that individual freedom, foundation of this country, is the way to go. And Gavin Newsom, governor of California, handsome guy, that's about it. How to burn a state down with bad land management, how to create an artificial water crisis. You know, California, just as an aside, this is out of the stupidity of expert regulation. They flush every year half of their natural rainfall into the Pacific Ocean. Only 10% of that annual rainfall goes for commerce and for residential use. 40% for agriculture, the rest is wasted. So when you hear about a water crisis, no, that's a politician regulatory crisis. So wherever it is, burning land, electricity, what's that? Any high taxes, driving people out, he wants to run on that? Come on, guy, we're ready for you. I don't care who the nominee is.
There is one other thing with regards to Swiss cars. They don't have green license plates, which means they don't follow the net zero and right. No green energy. Whereas, you know, as we talked about Europe and the decline of Europe, Germany is literally dead. I mean, we have killed our car industry. Imagine when we were the leading place in the world with car technology. Mm-hmm. And now those plants have to close thanks to green policies, thanks to these politicians yep. who rather believe that money comes out of thin air or the copy machine and electricity just out of the plug, full stop. And we are not only destroying our competitiveness, Europe is outrun. Yep.
And where are they sending their manufacturing centers? They're moving to Texas and Louisiana where we have cheap natural gas.
Which is great for them.
And obviously China. You were talking earlier backstage with me about central bank digital currencies. Tell us your kind of overview right now, what your expectations are moving forward with central banks around the world trying to implement CBDCs.
Well, there is huge differences. The Fed actually has stepped back on that and is not following through that on that front right now. The most advanced, to be honest, we just came back from a mission in China and saw Pan, the new big man in the People's Bank of China. He will be the next governor. And they are as really advanced. They will put it into place. It's actually already up and running. And they have the wholesales and retail digital currencies. They have all the business models in place. They will also use it for foreigners, interestingly enough. For those. And we looked into their technical parts. Europe wants to do the CBDCs. I'm not a big fan of CBDCs. I'm a fan of cash and alternatives, put it this way. And I also would like to have my money back up, and be on the safe side. So the CBDCs in Europe discussion is put forward by the European Central Bank and actually by the European Commission. We passed a white paper as of June 28th, and with the goal that this will be put into place by 2025. We will have European elections coming up next year, so you can imagine that there are plenty of people who just would like to stick to their old values and to good old cash and other tangible products in the monetary industry, and that this will be a big issue in the election campaigns. The Chinese and Governor Ueda looks at this from a very technical point of view. They have it ready to go, but they wait until they don't want to be the front runners. So I would rather say the Europeans are again the ones who will take the risk, and I hope I will probably not be in office anymore.
We have about 5 minutes left, and the big story globally, economically, is the BRICS, the movement of de-dollarization, de-globalization. 41 countries lining up now to try to join this economic and political movement. Preity, you know, start with the BRICS. Yeah. Give us your overview, and I would like to get Dr. Kolm and Steve's take on that as well.
All right. Just before BRICS, de-dollarization is this hot topic. If you read the headlines, it seems like there's a global rebellion against the U.S. dollar. So I just want to assure all of you, it's a bit of it's all fantasy, because 90% of the global trade is done in U.S. dollars, 60% of global reserves are in the U.S. dollars, and 40% of the global debt is issued in the U.S. dollar. So if you think you're going to change that overnight, it's just not going to happen. Now, in a multipolar world, there obviously will be other alternatives that will come up, and that is organic and that's natural. Countries have been, trading in each other's currencies forever, so there's nothing new in that. They will see a stark increase in that, and that's perfectly fine. Coming to BRICS, so in August, next month, the BRICS, the top five emerging markets in the world are going to be meeting, and this is where everybody thinks that they will be launching the BRICS currency. The problem with the BRICS currency is, other than the fact that these are great emerging markets, these countries have little to do with each other, and the trade deficit and the trade balance is not quite equal. So, and of course, a couple of them are the biggest adversaries of each other. So good luck with that, with getting all five of them to use a currency, especially if China wants to lead that. I can bet you the other countries are gonna run the other direction. So they have to be very pragmatic about it. Some of the BRICS countries obviously will make use of the currency if they do launch it, and that's perfectly fine. We have to move with the changing times in the world, and I think the U.S., I hope we get the right leadership, because the way that the rest of the world is moving, you need somebody who's economically sound and really knows which direction this country needs to head, or else we are in deep shit.
Well,
somebody's got to say it.
Well, I think everybody of us is, but the question is just who is the worst off, as you mentioned before, the number 25 in the index. So with regards to dollarization, and I would still think that the dollar, and you mentioned the numbers, will be number one also in the future. There are no alternatives right now. However, if we look at who is financing international infrastructure projects, and this is something where we definitely need to have a look. Here we lost out to Asia, especially to China. And if we look at the Asian Investment Bank, how much money they have already put on the plate with regards to Africa, with regards to other to the rest of Asia, down south, and even Europe already. So IMF and World Bank are losing out on that. I mean, they are just concentrating right now on minor things, looking at Ukraine, for example, and how to restructure this and rebuild this country again. But the big things are being financed already out of Asia. And this is where we create imbalances, and where we, from the West, will definitely have to have a close look in order to keep our independence and economic freedom, and especially the economic freedom, because those guys tick differently than we do.
Steve, last word?
The key thing is, in terms of a currency or anything else, if you have a trustworthy currency, i.e. it keeps a stable value, you will dominate the world. Look at the Dutch, 1500s, literally underwater, broke away from the Habsburg Empire, became the capital center of the world, created a global empire. How did they do it? Key thing was a stable currency. The Brits took it up with the pound when they took the pound seriously. We took it up from the British, having a sound currency. So after 2024, one of the issues that's going to come up, it'll be a peripheral issue, will be the Federal Reserve, the central bank. And the key thing is, if you don't fight inflation, I think a couple of candidates are already onto this, you don't fight inflation by trashing an economy. You do it by stabilizing the dollar. So in closing, I'll make a prediction. It'll be a few years before it'll happen. You can forget it if I'm wrong. But in a few years, the U.S. is going to have a new version of the gold standard.
All right, everybody, a big round of applause for Preity Upala, Dr. Barbara Kolm, and Steve Forbes. Thank you all very much for your time today. Enjoy the rest of the conference.
Thank you.
Project Veritas.